Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. Jenet Jacob Erickson, professor at Brigham Young University's School of Family Life, spoke at our annual student conference, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. This is her second talk, entitled, The Question We Never Thought We'd Ask, Do Kids Need a Mom and a Dad?
So the idea being that fathers really aren't essential because we can't prove in social science that they actually do something that's unique, that's masculine, that's uniquely masculine, and that can't be done by someone else. And the same thing has happened with mothers. Do mothers, in fact, do something that's uniquely maternal, feminine, and can't be done by someone else? Researchers agree that men and women parent differently, but the question is that due to masculinity and femininity being inherently different? Is it fixed? Is it something that doesn't change over time and that is consistent across people? And does it really matter? And so you can see all these questions going into this issue of, does it really matter if we have a father and a mother and your father and mother? Does it matter if it's these two different genders, or does it matter if it's any particular gender? And the conclusion, this was stated in the 2010 kind of big published article that said gender in fact doesn't matter. And Dr. Allen kind of took apart the studies that they were citing there in his recent presentation, but this was their conclusion. Two compatible parents, people who get along, provide advantages for children over single parents. We know that. There's something about two that seems to matter. But it's irrespective of gender. Gender doesn't seem to be an important issue in that. It's irrespective of marital status, sexual identity, or biogenetic status. That was their conclusion. And of course, we can take apart the research that they used to base that conclusion on. But what I'm going to do more than that is just talk through what we actually see about the unique contributions of fathers and mothers that was not part of this study's conclusions. They didn't use that information in coming to these conclusions. So this was their statement, their final statement. The gender of parents only matters in ways that don't matter. In other words, it really has no impact on children or their outcomes per se. So if we go back, the question's kind of shocking because for decades there's been a lot of talk about the importance of mothers, starting with psychology and attachment theory. You've heard about attachment theory. There's something about this powerful bond between a mother and child that seems to matter a great deal in how they do, especially social, emotionally. And so John Bowlby, you've heard of him, 1944, he comes out with this studied thieves in England, 44 thieves. And one of the things that he found consistent across those thieves is that they had a period of their early lives where they did not have a mother, or the mother had died. And so he's looking at this, what's this issue about mothers that consistently shows up in these people who are found committing crimes? And this is what he found out in his work as a psychologist. Children deprived of maternal care during extended periods, quote, lacked feeling, had superficial relationships, and exhibited hostile or antisocial tendencies. So you see lots of social, emotional, behavioral kind of problems coming up with that. And so he started what we call the attachment science, in a sense, about mothers and babies and their attachment. And with it, there was a woman that he worked with named Margaret Ainsworth, who's also well known, did a lot of work in Africa and in the United States. And she would watch. She just spent hours and hours watching mothers and babies interact. And she recognized that the quality of that interaction, not only just the fact that the mother's interacting, but the quality of the interaction seems to influence how that child turns out. Now, does this all seem intuitive? You've heard this your whole lives. She labeled it maternal sensitivity, and it comes up in our day as being important because of work done on daycare. And so how sensitive does a caregiver need to be, and does it need to be that mother? So she labeled it maternal sensitivity, the quality of that interaction, and she said it's the way a mother detects, interprets, and responds to needs. So as psychology's measuring how sensitive a mother is, they'll look at Is she positive in her interactions? You know, is she yelling shut up to that child or whatever? Things you've heard in the grocery store that cause you anxiety, right? Is she kind? Does she respect autonomy? This is a very interesting one. In other words, does she let the child move away from her a little bit and then come back? Does she allow kind of exploration, or is she very controlling? And less sensitive mothers were more controlling, or too controlling, they would say. So there's this fine balance of protecting and allowing for growth. And what they found out is that something about this early maternal sensitivity, the way she interacts with this child from birth on, influences their physical, and it provides the sense of protection psychologically and physically that's necessary for their development. And we know it doesn't stop even with early childhood, that mothers exhibit maternal sensitivity with their adolescence. Now, it's not going to be the child crawling away and coming back, right? But it'll be a monitoring and a sensitivity in the way she asks about their emotional well-being. And that this consistent maternal sensitivity over their life course seems to matter. I think this is fascinating. There's a man named Alan Shore who does it, who's a neuropsychologist, looks at the brain patterns, and what they can actually detect. He wrote a book in 1994, and he could watch the brain developing as this mother interacted with this baby. And they could actually watch some of the cerebral regions become active while this mother was looking at that child, just gazing at that child like mothers do when they have a new baby, right? She's breastfeeding the baby or bottle feeding the baby and looking at that child, and he could watch the brain actually developing that way. And what they recognized is that mothers, just like Jennifer Roback Moore said the first night, is all kinds of mothers seem to be incredibly able to modify the amount of sensitive input that they're giving just the right amount. They don't overstimulate, they don't understimulate, they seem to be able to be in tune with what exactly is needed. And this isn't PhD mothers, they might be worse than others. This is ordinary women who wouldn't have ever been taught or shown anything about how they're gazing, who sort of intuitively modify the input in appropriate ways. And so, as he would describe it, he'd say, through fine-tuned input, she's able to match and synchronize to that infant's, they call it inner state, their sort of emotional inner state, and provide the optimal chunked bits of stimulation needed for that child's developing right hemisphere. And he could watch this right hemisphere where social emotional things are happening develop right as she was doing that. And so in 2003, after the U.S. had done this, we'd gone through this crisis of, does daycare matter? You know that crisis. Does it really affect kids? And it was sort of an experiment, because as maternal employment went up dramatically and mothers were putting their children in the care of other people besides themselves or their husband, then the question was, well, we know attachment seems to matter. We've known that for some decades. Does this matter? Is there a problem with this issue? And so the United States started a very careful study. The NICHD, National Institute of Child Health and Human Development, did it, and they're still doing it. It's ongoing. They started it in the early 90s, and the question was does daycare really matter? They followed this sample of children, and they looked at them when they went into all their homes, and they looked at them when they were, you know, 5 weeks and then 12 weeks, and really careful, thorough analyses. And they'd watch how the mother interacted. If the dad was there, they'd watch how he interacted. But it was really to look at, when that child goes to daycare, does that seem to influence how they interact with their mother and their father, and does it influence teachers? And what they came up with was that regardless of how much time a child spends away from their mother, her sensitivity, just like Ainsworth and Bowlby had said, seems to be the strongest and most consistent predictor of their outcomes. And not just socially emotionally, but cognitively as well, that brain development. Something about the way she interacts when she's with that child, even if she's not with them all day, really impacts how they do developmentally. What they also found, though, is that the amount of daycare a child is in matters. Now, how many of you have heard this in the media? It's a really, really, really difficult thing to publish on, to get media to talk about, because most recently, a year ago, there was a study that came out, the kids are all right, maternal employment doesn't matter. And you'll often see that statement, the kids are all right. Underlying that statement, which makes child developmentalists nervous, I think, is just this assumption that the minimal amount that we give is what we care about, right? And if they seem to be okay, they're not all in jail, we should feel like things are, you know, things are coming along all right. But interesting that this very well done study did find some problems with the amount of time that children spent in non-maternal care. And what was interesting is it did not show up in the measures at age two. And think of what you would look at with a child like our child at age two. You're looking at, are they hitting kids? You know, do they interact? Do they talk? Whatever. The effects didn't seem to show up. Only occasionally in certain measures would they show up. And so out came the media splash. It doesn't matter, right? We've looked at two-year-olds, and it doesn't seem to matter for them how many hours they're away from their mother in non-maternal care. Three-year-old measures doesn't seem to matter. See? It's what we've thought all along. And then at 4.5, something happened. These children were preparing to go to kindergarten, so they're doing kind of thorough analyses of are they prepared for kindergarten, looking at all of that, and all of a sudden they see that for children who had 30 hours per week in non-maternal care from the time they were young, that would be like 9 months old and on, that it seemed to predict some problems socially, emotionally. Not necessarily cognitively, but socially, emotionally. And so they would say it meant less competence socially, less cooperation, more problem behaviors. This was my husband. He was in daycare from the time he was 6 weeks old, and I love to look at the measures from his assessments when he was little. This was Mike. And more aggressive, more negative moods, conflict. And that what was interesting is it had the same effect in predicting negative outcomes as poverty did, the same kind of effect size, if you will. And do we get worried about poverty? Yeah, a lot. That's seen as like, you want to get a kid out of poverty because it means lots of problems for them. And what they found is this had a similar effect size. So then, of course, they kept measuring. Maybe this will disappear when they go into kindergarten or first grade, second grade. And what they found out is first grade, it seemed like the children who had not been in non-maternal care developed more aggressive behaviors. So they looked more equal. Does that make sense? And so they kind of equalized out. But then by third grade, again, this same thing of more non-maternal care, 30 hours per week, they had fewer social skills and poor work habits. By the sixth grade, the negative outcomes only showed up if they'd been in center care, in daycare centers, which you can imagine is a little different than the neighborhood care that you have a child in with four other kids. The center care has a higher child to adult ratio, and so it can be more chaotic and a little bit difficult to, and so that showed up as a problem. Well, age 15, which came out just a couple of years ago, there were still problems, and it was related not just to center care, but to non-relative care. And of course, this wasn't all kids, but the risks were greater for children depending on how much time they'd spent in that non-maternal care. I think this one's also interesting because sometimes people will ask me, well, what if I have to put them in care? Is it better to wait that first year? Would you say the first year is most important if you can't choose for their whole early life? And I'll tell them one of the findings that hasn't continued to show up or hasn't been looked at very carefully came up in this one, and that was that a child who went into non-maternal care from 3 months old to 6 months old, so in that early, early period, that it was had the same predictive power of negative outcomes as the whole time, if you will. Isn't that interesting? And as we look at that, we find out that there's something about an infant, when we look biologically, when the infant separates from their mother, the measure of stress that we are most easily able to measure is cortisol levels. You've probably heard that. It's when you're stressed, you get higher cortisol levels. And so we find out that infants, when they are in daycare, increase in the amount of cortisol level in their blood over the day, whereas babies who are in the care of their mother at home decrease over the period of the day. And so people don't know, is there stress response that's causing some of this behavior that shows up later? Is it affecting the way the mind develops in terms of social emotional? What are the connections biologically? But there does seem to be something about infants experiencing extra stress when they're away from the care of their mothers. Okay. The last one that I want to point out here, you'll often hear, and maybe I should point this out, is, well, what if it's really good daycare, right? We've got them in really good daycare. And there is something to be said about high quality daycare, but the findings were far less strong than anyone anticipated. Everyone expected, surely it matters a lot if this is a really nurturing caregiver and if there's fewer children in the center, and it just didn't show up as powerfully as people thought. It does show up in terms of they learn their letters faster and they learn how to talk in big words a little bit faster, but in terms of their social emotional behavior, it doesn't seem to matter, except they did see that there's some fewer problems if they were in really high quality care. By age 15, you still see that it was positive. The problem is, those high quality daycare centers are so rare, right, that it's hard to even find what the NICHD would say was really high quality care. And this one's very interesting and important too, that the longer a mother was away from that baby, the less maternal sensitivity she had. And when I was discussing this with the original researchers, because I had to kind of interact with them about what, one of them said, yeah, that's what we saw, is less maternal sensitivity, and another who was sensitive about this finding, because you don't want to feel like you're less sensitive, right? She said, but it's also the way the baby's interacting with the mother that we were measuring, right? And it could be that that child actually develops less familiarity with that mother because they're not with them as much. And so it seems to happen in both directions, possibly. And it wasn't dramatic. We know that highly educated or more educated mothers who are married, who live in a stable situation, are more maternally sensitive. They're given all the things that help them to be more maternally sensitive. But even for them, longer hours away seem to decrease that sensitivity, and we get concerned about that because of how much sensitivity seems to predict other outcomes. Okay, so there's women, all right? So after this, then the question was, well, what if a man, a truly sensitive man, can learn to mother, right? And what about the capacity of a man to develop this maternal sensitivity ability? Do men do that? And so Andrew Doucet in 2007 published a book called, and she's Canadian also, you probably know her, but published a book looking at very carefully at fathers who had primary care of their children to see, do they in fact look the same as mothers? Do they exhibit the same kind of maternal sensitivity patterns that we could say are really important? And so if a man can learn to do that, it doesn't matter if it's her, right? And so she interviewed all kinds of fathers. She looked at them a lot. She watched the way they interacted. And I'll just share what she found. One of the first things she writes about is what fathers say about mothers. You would think, well, these dads, here they are, primary caregivers, mom's at work, or she's not present in some way. Do they think they replace the mother? What do they think about that? And interestingly enough, overwhelmingly, what do you think they said? No, right? They would say, they'd go back to when that baby was born and they'd say, I think it's a spiritual thing. They were with their mom before they came to earth. It's something we don't have, that extra special thing with children. They, even though they spent all kinds of time with that child, they would say there's just still something different. One of them said, you have to recognize that even as a stay-at-home father, you can't ever replace the mother. Don't even think about it. I can't do it the same way. This is one of my favorite ones is, it's not the same. She holds the baby more to her body. I mean, they'd be looking at this mother. Why is she holding the baby that way? I don't hold the baby that way, right? And she rocks the baby more. I love her and everything, speaking of this daughter, but I don't hug her as much. She's not part of me in the same way. And then this dad, I was there at her birth. I was there for all three of them, and I had a connection with them. But she had her body transformed. And of course, when we look at neuroscience, we can oxytocin measures and all kinds of other things, hormonal things that are happening in her body as she's breastfeeding and holding that child. There's, just like Bowlby said, she's biologically predisposed to attach in a particular way to this child that he couldn't have because his body doesn't have the same response. I don't think we can undermine the fact that women are connected to their children in that very physical and that very primordial sense. In my opinion, women have an edge in parenting, whether you say psychological or hormonal or whatever. So first of all, she just looked at, what do dads think about this? And then she started to watch how dads interacted with children to see, do they look the same? They think there's differences just in terms of how close these mothers are, but do they look the same? And she found these different things, which I think consistently show up. You've heard them probably before in other studies, but which one do you think cuddles and coos, and which one tickles and tosses? Where do we learn that? I from the time LaDawn was born, Mike was tickling and tossing her, and I was, what are you doing? Tossing her up in the air, right? And I'm talking to her and interacting with her in a particular way. And so she found over and over again, dads, and we've seen this in numerous studies, dads use play to connect with that child, where mothers do something different. They cuddle with them and they talk to them, whereas he's doing a lot of physical kinds of things with them. And she saw that in these dads' interactions. The other one was dads would say, and these are their words to talk about it, is I get them out as much as possible. They were big into taking them out to experience outdoor kinds of things more than the mother was. This is an interesting one. When the child would start to cry or have a problem, the dad would say, my first response is not to comfort that child. My first response is to fix the problem. And it just seemed like it was intuitive to them to say, well, what are we going to do about this, to fix this issue? And so where mothers would focus so much on making them feel better, this dad would, the way the author labeled it, was this sort of strategic indifference. He would act indifferent with the strategy of helping them deal with it and cope with it and overcome it and fix the problem. And then this one, I'm willing to let the kids fail. This idea that I got to encourage them to take that risk. And the mother's standing back there going, don't make them climb that high. No, that's too high. That's too far, right? And he's saying, they can do it. They can do it. And even when they're starting to fall, right, then he's wanting to encourage them to push a little harder, to do it a little bit more, something more difficult. And she's wanting to protect. And then finally, this is one of my favorite ones. She'd watch these fathers at home with them, and they'd say, it's time for lunch, you know, the dad, and he'd say, you guys can make your own lunches, right? Go in there and figure out how to make your own peanut butter sandwich or whatever. You know how to do that. And that there was this sense of promoting independence that dad seemed to have intuitively, that they wanted more than the mother did. So at first, this was interesting. Yes?
Would it surprise you to know that on the previous slide that my husband treats me like that in all those ways.
Okay, how many women would say the whole comforting thing? What, you know, they're trying to help us deal with the problem rather than feel comfort. All I want you to do is listen to me, right? How many times have you heard that, right? That's so interesting.
The first response is wanting to fix the problem.
Yeah.
You can't fix the problem.
Just hold me. Yes. Isn't that interesting how it seems to persist even in those relationships? Well, Andrea, take a walk outside, right? I think interesting that Andrea, to say she comes from a feminist background, right? And she describes it when she first looked at, and when I say she comes from a feminist background, it is to say men are not as involved as they should be. Okay, that assumption. Men are not parenting the way they should be. They don't father as sensitively as they should be. And so when she saw, for example, dads having their children make their own lunches, she said, my first interpretation was this was an evidence of the father letting go of his child, you know, just kind of taking it easy. He's sitting on the couch watching TV and letting him just do whatever. In contrast to dominant understandings of nurturing and protective care that suggest that the parent is holds on to the child. In other words, she said, shouldn't a nurturing parent just hold on to them and help them and make it easier, that kind of thing? Gradually, however, I came to view this behavior as an integral part of nurturing, which was interesting. That is, and when we look at maternal sensitivity, we see this. That is, the protective care of children with its qualities of attentiveness and responsiveness and competence involves holding on and what else?
Letting go.
And you can see that easily in maternal sensitivity. A mother who holds on too much is going to cause trouble for the developing child. And so there's this very fine balance of holding on and letting go that she would see fathers seem to balance mothers' natural intuition that way in enabling that part of nurturing to happen. And so the conclusion was they are nurturing. That is an important part of nurturing, though it looks different. But, she said, men do not mother. Her conclusion was, it doesn't look the same. It doesn't seem to matter how much time they're with that child. It just doesn't look the same. And things that showed up that were interesting is that mothers who would go to work versus fathers that would go to work, full time. When she would come home, that mother's first question often was, where are the kids? How are the kids? Very tuned in to parenting, and she would step right into parenting, this mothering role. He was different when he would come home from full-time work. He didn't step in necessarily. And so she recognized women and men, whether we're conditioned to be this way or whether it's just intuitive to us, they see their responsibility in parenting and nurturing a little bit differently. She's going to be there, in a sense, even though she's working full-time. And as soon as she's back, she's going to be really present. And then father, she just said, experienced as she watched them, they would talk about this. It's like they have their heart edges softened. They recognize the value of caring work the more time they spend with their children. And they articulate a commitment. She would say they're kind of transformed by this, and that they articulate a commitment to taking on women's work. But these fathers are not mothering, and they are not mothers. They're reconfiguring fathering the way we've typically thought of it. In a sense, it looks a little bit different than just a father who is less present. And they're reconfiguring masculinities, in a sense, but they're not doing the same thing that mothers do. So, Biblars and Stacy, when they were looking at this, when they came to the conclusion that that gender doesn't matter, one of the things that was interesting is they their studies were flawed. And did you talk about this?
No, I quoted them, but I didn't actually talk about the study.
But you talked about the studies that fed into this study, probably. And so often what they were looking at is single fathers versus single mothers. Well, who do you think showed up as the better nurturer? Mothers did, right? Because our measures for nurturing are tuned in to how mothers nurture. They measure maternal nurturing, in a sense. And so they also looked at the differences between married wives and husbands. Well, how do you think? Do you think, who's going to show up better in that in terms of nurturing? The married wife, right? The way we measure it, she's going to show up better. There were no studies of planned gay fathers that included child outcomes. So we couldn't really look at how does a gay dad, does he look more like a mother, in a sense, traditionally. And so what happened with that article is, the way Jennifer Roback Morse would say it, is that mothers and fathers are equal, except mothers are better, right? And they are interchangeable, except mothers are better. And the idea was that what they were measuring as sort of the ideal parenting, and they came to the conclusion that two lesbian mothers is actually better, the better parenting situation than any other parenting situation. Because what do you have a lot of? In two lesbian mothers? A whole lot of this middle class kind of mothering paradigm. And you have a whole lot of that stuff showing up. And that female parents were better than heterosexual men. They showed more respect for children's autonomy. There was more warmth, affection, attachment. And so the conclusion was that these mothers, two mothers, is going to be the best situation. And so I just put it up there, men and women are the same, but women are better. And so this conclusion, two women parent better on average than a woman and a man, or at least than a woman and a man with the traditional division of household labor. Now, what's the big problem, do you think, for them with a mother and a father together? Because mothers and fathers, we know that when women get married and have children, they actually become more traditional in their division of household labor than they might have thought they would become. Now, what drives that is probably because that baby is super dependent and connected to that mother, right? How many times did Mike want to get up in the night, but he couldn't get up in the night with her the same way I could because he couldn't feed her, right? And so it looks very traditional. That was a hang-up for them, because the idea was, well, we're perpetuating these patterns of division of household labor that are presumed to be unhealthy, and so inherently a father and a mother are not going to be as good as two lesbian mothers, because inherently there's going to be a more traditional, almost inherently there will be a more traditional division of household labor. Does that make sense? So one of the biases inherent in their conclusion was that this traditional division is inherently bad. And so when we expose children to it, it's a bad thing.
When you say better, are you talking about in the short term or long term in terms of the outcome of the child's development?
And so this is a really good question. And most of our measures look at when they're 5 years old. Are they hitting people, right? When you're comparing, you're saying lesbian, the outcomes for lesbian mothers. You're looking at little children and their behaviors, and are they pleasant and nice, right? And it looks like there's no differences. We don't have studies. There are no studies, except the most recent study by Regnerus that gets a little bit better picture of that, and we'll talk about that, of long-term outcomes. We just don't have anything like that.
Are there any comparisons of nanny states versus natural parents?
Of nannies versus
the
natural
parents? State. It's taking over the role of parents.
Yeah.
The government.
Yeah, well, and that's a good question. All we have is Russia to compare with, probably, right?
Mm-hmm.
We have state institutions
China.
That care for children, and it didn't
China.
Look that great. Or China, right? Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to... What Regnerus did just most recently that you heard, and I think you... Did you talk about this also, Doug? Just briefly. His study just looked... Published in 2012, just a couple of months ago, looked at 15,000 adults and took out of that group any who said their parents had had a same-sex relationship during their growing up, a same-sex relationship. And then he looked at outcomes. Now, you can imagine people were critical of, well, this isn't the same as same-gender parenting. You're not actually measuring that necessarily because you're looking at whether or not this person had a relationship, a sexual relationship with a same-gender person. But what is helpful is that that's generally how it looks, meaning it's not, we're not looking at a sample of people, a big sample of people who consciously are gay from the time they're five and decide to, you know, find a lifelong partner and then adopt a child, and we're measuring outcomes there. That's a really tiny sample of people. Most of the time, it's far more chaotic than that, right? Relationships are kind of in and out, and they're not stable. And so in some ways, he was getting a picture of what things, at least during those years, you know, prior to 2012, when these children were growing up, what it really looked like in that kind of same-sex world. And so he just found that 20 out of 40 outcomes, in 25 of those outcomes, children who had had mothers, in particular, who had lesbian relationships, they fared far worse. And one of the most shocking things, and there were seven, as you said yesterday, too, is seven measures of sexual kind of abuse problems that they were especially high in, meaning children were exposed to or experienced sexual abuse in those kinds of families. And it was very, you know, there were seven different measures of that, of really, really awful things. And so he was trying to help us see there's a lot more to look at, and your comment about looking at long-term effects. What about these children when they are trying to form families of their own, and how do they look back on their childhood that we haven't had studies of before? Okay, so then I want to, that kind of takes us through the mothering stuff and where we are in terms of conclusions about mothering. So are dads then disposable? And what do we know about what dads uniquely contribute? And I told you, students read this article that came to the conclusion they're not essential. They don't offer something that's uniquely masculine that can't be replaced. But having said that, there's just so much evidence that there are problems when children don't grow up without fathers. Now, I've asked people why this gap. In other words, when we look at measures of what dads do, we don't seem to see something unique necessarily, although I showed you some of the unique things fathers do that she looked at that are irreplaceable. And yet when we look at all of these sociological studies, we see that there's something really serious that happens when children don't grow up without their dads. And there seems to be a problem with what we're measuring, right, with our way of looking at things. Because clearly they seem to be really important. So let's start with this one. This one's often ignored because the assumption is, well, a mom can make money too, right? Why are we talking about dads being important because they earn money? But the reality is that a child is so dependent that it takes two people to ensure that that child can be raised. We're different than horses. We're different than whales, right? We're different than all kinds of other mammals in that that child comes out so helpless and so dependent that someone has to be nurturing that child. And then that person is also dependent on another to nurture them. And you'll find out if a mother isn't dependent on her husband in that nurturing process, she's dependent on somebody. The government, right? Somebody has to come in and help support that. And so money matters a lot. And we find out, of course, that married fathers increase the amount of work hours. There's something about this wanting to provide for and protect in that way that seems to be innate in them. And and that enables that mother to then nurture, in a sense. So married fathers are still the primary earners in at least 69% of families. They earn most of the income. They enable that process to happen, enable her to be dependent so that she can care for that child. But they're not just ATMs, right? They're not just money sources either. That's not all they do. But I think this one gets often ignored. It matters a lot. We know that when children grow up in a single mother family, what is the first thing that happens? Almost always, poverty. They struggle with money. They struggle with difficult money situations, and that affects a lot of other things. So this is a key one. But then, of course, if you look at all these other outcomes, and I think this is so interesting, this shows up over and over again, that boys who grow up with their dads and girls who grow up with their dads both experience this sense of protection, self-worth. The way I've heard one man talk about it, who's done a lot of research in there, is he'll say that boy who grows up with his dad, it's like he has this very strong sense of how to protect, how to channel his energies, how to channel his emotions in ways that will protect the people around him, protect women, protect others, not harm them. And she, it's like she walks out of that house with a shield around her, that girl who grows up with a dad. And it's communicated to the people around her, this sense of herself. So boys develop self-control. Seems like they develop this sense of self-control when they've got a father present. And girls develop this sense of self-protection. So just one quick statistic, we see this repeated. Boys without dads are 2 times more likely to be in prison before age 30. And you see that over and over again. There's something about self-control that dads seem to imbue in sons. And girls whose fathers left before age 6, and we looked at this statistic yesterday, are 6 times, can you imagine that? The most recent study shows 6 times more likely to be pregnant as teens. And what's interesting is that when they grow up with a stepdad, you've seen the Ellis work, probably you've heard about, that shows that her menstruation starts younger than girls who grow up with their dad. It's kind of premature, and then she's more likely to become sexually active with a stepdad than she is just with a single mom. There's something about having that other male figure in the house that seems to, and people say, is it pheromones? Is she responding to his pheromones, right? Her body's responding to that. Other people say it's not quite as clear, but this we do know. They're more likely to become sexually active when they don't have a father present. And so one of the conclusions that comes out is dads are providers and dads are protectors, and there's something unique about what they do in both those realms that's important. We find out that dads are really critical in terms of monitoring their activities. Children develop this sense of accountability about dad's going to want to know where I was, and it's going to matter who I was with and what I was doing. And that dads do a lot in terms of monitoring, even if they're not home all day. Just checking in with that child briefly at dinner is something that seems to matter in terms of the risks of the kinds of risky behaviors they engage in. And then this interesting thing, that boys that grow up with dads and girls that grow up with dads, they seem to communicate to the people around them that their dad's going to protect them, that they're not vulnerable to gangs. You know, so sad that the horrible things that happened at Penn State, and in each of those young men who were victims of that abuse did not have a father. Right? There was no dad. And one of the things that dads do is they communicate this sense of, I will tolerate no harm to this child, and I will beat you up if you hurt this child, or I'll help this child beat you up, right? And something about this sense of not tolerating harm that fathers communicate. And so they end up being strong protectors from physical, sexual, and emotional abuse. And as the students who were here yesterday saw, we know that the highest risk situation for children is to be in a situation with a single mom and a cohabiting dad or a boyfriend. That, and like you said, the statistics that talk about it in terms of married relationships are just way overblown. It just doesn't happen in the same way. They are just so much more vulnerable to that kind of abuse where there isn't their father present and some other man who's present there. And what's tricky is that single moms are often in relationships. We know it's like a merry-go-round for single mothers often, that there are people coming in and out of that house, especially low-income, middle-income situations, men coming in and out of that house, and who don't have that relationship with that child, and so it makes for very vulnerable situations. And then, of course, this is what 10 times more likely to be abused when they were in a home with an unrelated male. And then statistics that we could just briefly show about fathers, that child poverty increases, and we looked at these yesterday. The sexual activity, child abuse, jail, depression, school expulsion, developmental problems, behavior problems, marijuana use, cocaine use, weapon carrying, health, just physical health, domestic violence, child poverty, serious child abuse. And so you just see there's all this evidence that children who grew up without fathers are more likely to experience a whole host of problems. And so they clearly do something that matters and that mothers can't do in the same way, can't communicate in the same way. What I think is important and interesting from the conclusions that we come to when we look at do men mother and how do they look in terms of mothers and fathers, often men are criticized for not being emotionally connected, not doing as much emotion work as women do. When we say emotion work, we'll measure, well, the mother asks questions about how are you feeling and gives compliments and does all kinds of emotional connection. And so men will be criticized for doing less emotion work. But what we find out is when children get older, so when they're really young, that seems to be the case. And then when they get older and they're trying to apply for a job, who do they go to? Dad. Or they're trying to get help with figuring out finances, or they're trying to figure out how they're going to get a car, or as soon as they start interfacing with the outside world, he seems to provide emotion work in very different levels and in ways she can't do as easily. And mothers themselves will acknowledge that. They'll say, he's the humor side, whatever, and I'm the intense side, or he adds the emotion work of play. But because we don't measure it very well, it looks like men are just hanging out, doing no kind of work, right, in the family in terms of emotions. But what it shows is that couples move back and forth in their view of who is more nurturing, in which contexts, and at which times. In other words, she might say, I took care of the baby, and I was the nurturing influence on that baby. But as they got older, they kept going to dad for help on all these other things. And I couldn't do those same things. So, of course, it's rooted in all these issues of trying to balance work and care that seem to require that there be two in order to fulfill the full range of needs developmentally across the lifespan of that child. And that they do it in different ways at different times. And then finally, as we talk about this, if we come back to this conclusion that maternal sensitivity really matters, and I think it does, mother's sensitivity matters a lot in the development of that child, especially during those early years, that is very related to her relationship with her husband. And the contrast is the same looking the other direction. In other words, how the mother treats the husband and the relationship that they have influences his fathering tremendously. If she's kicking him out, if she's gatekeeping him from things, if their relationship is ruptured or divorced, then he's not going to spend as much time with those children. He experiences a lot of his relationship with those children often through that mother. And so keeping that relationship strong enables him to be, or healthy, or communicative, or cooperative, enables him to be better connected to those children. And the same for her. We know mothers do better when they're in a stable married relationship in terms of their own sensitivity. When they're being provided for, when they know about what it means to be sensitive and are given the resources that enable them to not be as stressed about other things so they can be sensitive, she's better. She's a better mother when she's cared for by that husband. And this one, you can imagine that all the studies that show when there's a man coming in and out of that house and she's breaking up with guys and coming back in, and there's a lot of maternal stress that's experienced that then is communicated to those children. She's not as good a mother that way. And similarly, if she's worried about financial security in their marriage, she's worried about providing, it's harder to be as sensitive as a mother and provide what's needed for those children. Okay. I'll just end with this quick anecdote that Andrew Doucet shows at the end of her book, she spent all this time talking to fathers, and she's tried to generate a sense for, gosh, don't you guys hate how you're treated as stay-at-home dads? You know, you're not as respected in this world that, you know, sees you as less masculine. And she's trying to kind of generate feelings of victimization, I think she would say, you know. And what can the political world do to help you? And so one of the questions she asks is, in an ideal world, what resources or supports would you like to see for single fathers? And I think she expected, you know, policies that would be more helpful, a change in cultural attitudes that would, you know, value us and see us as important. And she said it was just quiet for like 2 minutes. Nobody talked in this group of dads. And then finally one of them stood up, and this was his comment. An ideal world would be one with a father and a mother. And these are men who don't have mothers caring for their children because of death, divorce, or other situations. So he's saying, we know an ideal world would be one with a father and a mother. We'd be lying if we pretended that wasn't true. How can there be an ideal world without a mother for the children? And it just really took her back. And so her conclusion was, men do not mother. And women mother in ways that are unique from men. Men father in ways that are unique from what women contribute. And the ideal world that they even see and acknowledge is one in which the two of them work together. They know they can't provide what the other one could, is what she was finding out from these fathers. Okay, well, questions. Thank you. Yes.
Hundreds of thousands of university students and community college students studying child development.
Yeah.
Is any of this information getting to them? What are they being taught? Are they being given misleading information about the needs of the child as they develop? Do you know?
Yeah. Sometimes I felt like the child development world was less prone to those kind of biases than family sociology or other areas. In other words, because they're focusing on child outcomes, then they're usually more honest. Because they're not focusing on what adults want, they're more honest about what children seem to need and depend on. But there's also, it can seem threatening. It can be threatening to talk about the unique differences that men and women offer for both sides. It's threatening in the sense, well, does that mean gay relationships aren't as good? Or does that mean women should all stay at home, right? And so you can see it's politically charged and threatening. And so I think people are sensitive, but when they're honest about what they look at, I think you have to show that. Father research is more recent. We have decades of maternal research because it's easier to do, because mothers tend to be with their children historically more than fathers, so you can measure it better. So fatherhood is, what's happened is we did a lot of research on fatherhood and came up with, I think, a lot of these conclusions. And then there's been a decrease in fathering research as there's been an increase in this political agenda towards same-sex relationships. And so the conclusion is more like, well, fathers are disposable. And so you hope child developmentalists are free a little bit of that bias. But, yeah, hard to say.
It seems to me that a lot of the so-called current trends preceded us in Europe. So are there studies going back to their experience that we're only learning about in this country?
Yeah, they certainly preceded us in terms of what I've shared with their non-maternal...
The data corresponds?
With non-maternal care research. And I think they have mixed conclusions. But it wasn't always as carefully done. And I think you have to think that their context is a little bit different. It's much more homogeneous in Sweden, right? You're dealing with a very different kind of tradition. But in terms of fatherhood, we don't use European studies for fatherhood, I think, because they're not done. Yeah. I don't think... Do you think anything... Europe and they're using them as sources for understanding what fathers... It looks the same, though. Outcomes for children without dads is similar in Europe. Yeah.
Like Jenet, you know, she was hinting at how you mentioned there are these time studies over time. You know, Biblars, and I can never pronounce her name, Biblars and Stacey.
Yeah.
they were sort of, they weren't doing original research, they're just reporting on these studies. And those studies are all of young children. They're only interviewing the mother. They define parenting as mothering.
Yes.
And from one study to another, they're never asking consistent questions. So not only is there nothing over time, you can't even really compare them across time.
And we have more than Europe does, probably. And so, yeah. Yes.
I have a question about this. Is a little bit unrelated, and I realize there may not be any studies yet, but I'm wondering about children who are conceived through in vitro with either sperm donation or egg donation.
Right, who also don't know their fathers.
Right, like what is the biological importance of a child being raised with their biological mother, their biological father? Does it matter? I think it probably does, but is there any studies, is there research being done on, does it matter if there's a mother and a father present, but one of those or both of those parents aren't actually biologically related to the child?
I think interesting to look where we can look at that. And there is some research on those conceived by sperm donation. And what you find out is, I think as they get older, there's especially this longing to know who their biological parent is. I mean, a yearning that is so deep. And then they get connected to someone else, a father-in-law or whatever, and then it's even deeper. But it's interesting that the adoption studies, because often children are adopted into well-to-do families, right? So you look at, these are good situations. And yet they seem to fall in between those that come from like single parent or divorced families and biological families. So that cannot make up for the biological connection. I heard Brad Wilcox one time say there's something that happens in the heart of that child with biological connections.
Yeah, any study off the top of your head that would be good to look into?
About adoption?
Yeah, because that would probably be the most.
Yeah, I don't have any right off, but I can help you find them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Joanne, I think David Blakenhorn's.
Yeah. Institute for America, and they have...
On
the in vitro stuff. Yeah, I think they have the best stuff on in vitro for sure. But in terms of adoption, I'll have to help you get. Yeah. Sorry.
In the research that you were talking about where it was comparing non-mothering versus mothering at various ages, stages of development, was there any distinction made between strangers being the
versus family?
Versus family, because I hear a lot of people say, "Well, grandpa and grandma can do it, and it should be pretty much the same." Are there any studies that show there's?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I think early on, when they were comparing samples, like when they looked at nannies, you know, who are in the home, grandparents, fathers, some of those samples are really hard because they're so small relative to other kinds of care situations, but they didn't see differences, meaning they looked like the daycare kids. But then at age 15, what's interesting is it shows up the negative effects persist for non-relative care only. So if they were cared for by relatives or by a father, they don't seem to persist, at least through age 15.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think my feeling is, when I look at all that data, if you can have a smaller situation, a neighborhood situation, the more related... Because there are a lot of women who find themselves in a situation where they have to put them in care, then that's better than a center care situation. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
I know it's anecdotal, but about 2 weeks ago, Elton John, who's sort of like this iconic figure, came out and said that he thinks it's regrettable that the child he has with his partner will not have a mother.
Yeah, how interesting. Just natively.
And that's someone who, you know, is sort of iconic
for advocating for no difference there.
Wisdom comes with age sometimes.
Hindsight.
Yeah.
I was just wondering, one thing about the Regnera study that kind of stuck out to me
is
that the rates of abuse in households where there was a same-sex relationship seemed to be comparable or sometimes higher than households that were just single parent or otherwise broken homes.
Yeah.
I was just wondering, what is it about the condition of there being a same-sex relationship that causes these high levels of abuse, and why shouldn't... I imagine they should be closer to single parent.
Yes.
They seem to be higher. I was wondering why that is.
Yes. Well, Doug, you probably have some comments on that.
I think it's two things. It's the biological relation. So in a single-parent home, you still have the parent biologically related to the child. And in the same-sex household, there's at least one who's not. So that's a problem, a major problem.
Yeah.
And the second thing is the monitoring. In the single-parent home, you don't have another spouse monitoring you. So when you lose your temper and, you know, you may become physically violent, there's nobody there to correct that behavior. Whereas that element is in present in the two-parent same-sex household. It's not as strong of an effect as the biological issue.
Yeah.
So I think it's the two issues combined in the two different types of households.
Do you think, too, Doug, just wondering, because one of the things that we see is that they're more likely to experience sexually deviant choices and behavior, and there might be something about the dynamic of the sexual preferences of that family that actually lead to more sexual communication. I don't know.
Yeah,
more.
We don't know. That's
we just don't know. We're speculating if we go anywhere else. Does that help?
Yeah, thanks.
There is something powerful about that biological tie. There, in terms of protection and safety, and yeah.
Could you direct us to other books, resources, websites for more information on just, you know, what we learned from our biological parents, mother, father?
Yes. Yes, I think the National Marriage Project has some good resources, although, you know, David Blankenhorn published Fatherless America, that's just kind of a rough look at the risks of not having fathers. And then it feels like all the motherhood stuff is just in separate books. I mean, you could look at Alan Shore's book about maternal nurturing, but I can't think of any book that actually says this is what fathers do, this is what mothers do. Of course, I referred to Do Men Mother by Andrew Doucet, but that looks more, it doesn't specifically go into motherhood very much. Yeah. I know, it's an eclectic group. I can give you this reference list, but yeah, it's an eclectic group of studies.
Yeah.
And then we'll come to you, but yeah.
Yes, this is what I kind of learned from some professors from San Diego State.
Yeah.
And I just want to ask if this sounds okay.
Yeah.
Basically, what I learned is that usually men, when are kind of like hunters or warriors, it's kind of like over time. And like the ladies or the women, they tend to be left at the cave or the town to tend whatever.
Yeah.
And like we carried it over to the modern age or something like that. Is that correct, or is it precise?
I think that falls into a whole realm of evolutionary theory, right? That the assumptions are that we all evolved over time and that we are the way we are because of past work that we did. And so it's a particular paradigm. What I think it does offer is that there seem to be unique contributions that men and women make. And I appreciate that about an evolutionary biological perspective. How they came about, there's many different theories about that, right? So in my faith, we believe gender is an essential part of our nature from before this life, through this life, and for eternity, that we will be women and men forever, and that we were born with innate gifts and characteristics that define us by gender. So, but that's a particular way of looking at it, and evolutionary theory is right. Yeah, thank you, yeah.
You know, these are sort of like snapshots, as you studies indicate, of time, but I would suppose that there are studies that show when a father is absent early on versus when a father departs from a family,
yeah,
at teenage or junior high level and so on,
yeah,
the impact
is different.
Yes.
Uh-huh. One of the things we know that we talked about yesterday that's been clear that way is if a father leaves before a girl is 6 years old, the chances of sexual promiscuity or early sexual development are much higher than if he leaves even between 6 and 15. But then there are different issues that seem to emerge when dads leave when they're adolescents.
And the size of the family probably has another factor on the children.
I'm sure.
You know, number of siblings.
Yes.
And if they're the firstborn or the lastborn.
Right. Who's able to provide parenting,
yeah,
fathering kind of influences, an older brother or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
There's a question about your statement that you made a moment ago, which I had not heard before.
Yeah.
And that was, you indicated that of all the men who were apparently sexually assaulted by...
Yeah. At least those who testified.
Kent State.
Yeah.
That to a man, if I understood you correctly,
yeah,
not a single one had a father biological father, at least specifically, but father to protect them. Did I understand you correctly?
Well, I just as I and I just read through the a little bit. It's too hard to read, but a little bit of some of their backgrounds and the program itself that they were involved in was for vulnerable youth. So in some ways, they were selected because they didn't have fathers, right? But I just think it's interesting.
Yeah, well, I think it's interesting, too. In fact, I think it's so interesting that that should be front page news. In fact, what I'm thinking as you are talking is we have the Louis Free Report, which I have not read, but I've heard reported on, is scathing in its indictment of who? The surrogate father being the state as the should have been the protector of these boys.
Oh, very interesting.
And
yeah.
What's so fascinating to me is we are then missing the elephant in
yes,
the room,
yes.
Which is, where was
are
the
dads?
Father?
Yes.
And I mean, gosh, we need to shout that from the housetops.
Yes.
This is like the time to speak up and warn the society.
Yes.
Hey, you take fathers out of the house, and this is what kinds of things happen.
Yes. No, I think that's exactly right. I think over and over again, there is something powerful about a father being present that protects that child. And I don't know if we walk out of the house and people sense that, you know, that there's a dad close.
A complex web of things.
It probably is, but there's obviously something that happens there. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
It is true that predators do look for fatherless children or children who don't have protectors, for one reason. The other thing is to answer father's question about resources. I don't know a lot about resources about parenting, but there's tons of resource or information out there about the differences between men and women.
Yeah.
Specifically brain differences.
Yes.
Men and women even hear differently. Women have a broader range in their hearing.
Wavelength differences, yeah.
Wavelengths, yeah.
Fascinating.
Attention.
Yeah.
Men's attention is more
focused.
Analysis and focus, where women are better at synthesis and being broad.
Yeah.
So there's tons of research on that. So all you have, it's an easy step to go from that, which people love talking about. Mm-hmm.
To how they would parent differently.
Now let's just transfer that over to parenting.
Yeah, and so, why a child would need both.
Yeah, and people have a field day with that. So there might not be a lot on parenting per se, but there's abundant research on differences between men and women.
Yeah.
The other thing I want to say is just coming from a philosophical standpoint, all of this is St. Thomas has a principle, action follows being, right? That is, your activity follows your being. And so this just shows that the real difference is men and women, since we are different, we act differently. Mm-hmm. So even though a woman can, or a man can do what a mother does,
yes,
he can do it as
in the same way
it.
As
yeah,
she does it.
In the same way. So, and this, I think, is also one of the reasons why the culture that's fighting for same-sex marriage also is fighting against the idea
gender.
That men and women are
different.
Our genders fit. Mm-hmm. Because if we can choose our gender, then all these studies that we're talking about, well, then that doesn't really matter.
Right.
Because, look, I'm just as female as I want to be.
Right.
So they're at war with the idea that our identity is rooted in our sexuality, and instead they want to replace it with our identity is rooted in our sexual preference.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Is there anything else? I think we're done.
Did these get handed out? Or would you like me to hand them out?
That would be great. I did not hand them out. I think these are they evaluation forms? No.
The questions
oh, they're handouts. They're handouts for you. Sorry about that. So you can get those as... Is there any other question? I'm so sorry, yeah.
This is just piggybacking up an earlier comment, but you mentioned the increase in sexual deviancy in certain households, and I was wondering if...
Yeah.
I'm not sure if the Regnera study said this, but is there evidence that kids who are raised in households where the parents are the same gender tend to adopt that identity or become more open to it?
Yes, there is evidence of that they are more likely to become same gender attracted themselves to...
Is that because of... You think that's related to the role of the mother and the father, or is it something...
I do. I think it's tricky to know exactly, you know, but I think the patterns that they're watching and their sexual development, we know fathers matter a lot for sexual development. There's something about dad's and daughter's development and son's development sexually that matters a lot. And so if they don't have a father there, for me, there's no question there's going to be some sexual development differences. Yeah. So, yeah, good comment.
Did I understand that the children reared in a same-sex family
are more likely
to become same-sex preference?
Yes.
Significantly?
Yeah, and again, these are really small studies,
right,
but that's we do see that fairly consistently, Doug, don't you think?
download your PowerPoint from anywhere?
I think they will make it available through ITAF. I think so. I think through the conference, and I'm happy to share it. So, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
You've just been listening to Dr. Jenet Jacob Erickson giving her talk, "The Question We Never Thought We'd Ask: Do Kids Need a Mom and a Dad?" from Ruth Institute's annual It Takes a Family to Raise a Village student conference. ITAF is a scholarship-based 3-day event in San Diego where students and people of all ages gather for seminars and inspiration on the meaning and value of marriage. It's held every year at the end of July. For information on past and future conferences, check out our website. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Robeck Morse pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.